Hello, everybody. We are live. We're going live early. And tonight, our guest is handwriting expert, Kate Gladstone, and she's going to show us on her screen exactly how she creates a new handwriting font. Without further ado, Kate Gladstone.
Yes, and I'm very glad to be able to do it. It's one of the joys of the computer age that anyone can sit down and make a font. And what's more, anyone can make a font out of their own handwriting. Aya has a list that she will probably share at some time, a list of sites I've shown her, many of which are fonts where you literally draw on the screen. There are also apps where you, including web apps or apps that you can download where you can print out a grid, fill it in with what you think the letters ought to look like in your handwriting. You know, this is my A, this is my B. And you can actually create them. Although, and today we will have a demo of actually writing one on the screen. Although there are other approaches. There are, for instance, even apps that let you put together little geometric shapes and make fonts. But I've looked at a lot of apps. What we have here are lists of all kinds of apps, background for some of what we can do. There are some background articles about how to make fonts, how to install them on anything from a phone or tablet, if it's the kind that you can load fonts onto for apps, you know, for your word processing. And some of them will let you do that, to literally having it on your, you know, your Word document that you might type. Now, of course, the other person won't see it in your document unless either you made it a PDF, which preserves the font information, or you sent them the font so they can install it. And, you know, but of course, you don't want to send people free a bootleg pirated font. There are some commercially made fonts that are free, but not a lot of them. But if you made a font yourself, you could actually have some good results. And believe it or not, the software on some of the font creation apps, not the one I'll be showing tonight, which is a rather middle of the road one, but on some of them, is so sophisticated, it's hard to tell the results from the actual handwriting of the person who made the font. If you scroll to where we have a picture of two handwriting samples, these are actually from a premium ultra handwriting font service called Scriptalizer, which is at one of the links in the list. And I would like you to look at these and ask yourself, you might remember if you're old enough, the commercial that advertised recording tape recorders, and it asked, is it live or is it Memorex? Well, I'm going to ask you, okay, well, this gave away the answer, but for those who haven't read the small type, guess which of these two, one or two, is the original real handwriting? And people look at it and, you know, they say, oh, yeah, it's got to be one, has got to be the real, because the baseline is a little more wobbly. And there's this giveaway. There's this big cross out. Someone crossed out a word and changed it. Believe it or not, number one is the font. This is a very top of the line, sophisticated font service that even has little tweaks to randomize the baseline if you want, and even to insert little mistakes and crossouts at approximately any specified frequency. In other words, you could specify, I want to cross out roughly every one in 100 words, and that will do it. Now, wow. A lot of times we get letters that appear to be handwritten, you know, from businesses, very often from charities or, you know, a community event type of places or something of that sort. And a lot of the ones that look like handwriting are actually fonts. Usually you can tell if you look closely, because usually it might look handwritten, but if you look closely, see, oh, all the Y's are the same or all the O's are the same.
We but have a comment from Chrysalis. Yes. And Chrysalis says, two looks less neat.
Two is less neat. So you are very perceptive, because one is the font and two is the real thing. Now, interestingly, most people think that one has to be the real thing because they're looking at the crossouts and they're looking at the slightly wavy baseline, which I understand is part of number one, which I understand is part of the programming. In other words, you literally can tell the app how much to screw up. But I have to say that Chrysalis, I wonder if you're a typographer or a calligrapher because you have a very perceptive eye. Now, for the rest of this, I have just links that you'll be able to follow. I only put in one graphic, which was that one, because I want us to focus on the fact that there are loads of these. And I want us to focus on what I will be doing. Tonight, I have borrowed my husband's iPad, which is much bigger than mine, because I'm going to use that to actually do an actual font, which you can do and install on anything that you can install fonts on. It comes out in one of the regular font formats. And for those of us who have devices that can use fonts, which are many types of tablets, some types of phones, and of course our desktops and laptops, you literally could make your own font, and people make them for fun. People make them to sell. Now this is starting to be a big thing. It didn't used to be a big thing, except a few decades ago, a lot of the handwriting companies started to make their own fonts with very sophisticated programming. If it was a cursive font, so the letters would all join. Before that, there was a lot of work. You basically, if you wanted something that looked like handwriting in a book, and it was 50 years ago, let's say you were talking the 1950s, the 1970s, you had to have something very specially designed on, you know, the old type of equipment. You know, there was linotype, and before that, you know, metal type. It would have to be very precisely designed. If you were trying to imitate an actual join up all the letters or join up some of the letters, you had to play a lot of tricks. Not everything would quite work out perfectly. Sometimes you had to do some compromises. But now you literally can write on the screen and do this. Now, some apps, they will either let you print, they will either let you do it for free, or they will have it often a free and a pro level of service. And with the pro, you might get more characters like accent marks and symbols and the ability to do more than one alphabet in the font, like to have, let's say, English and Greek or English and Hebrew or something. But some of them will have things, tricks you can do with the spacing, joining. A lot of the pro levels of these apps will have things where literally, if you're making a font that is supposed to join letters, as in most handwriting, you know that if you look at a standard cursive style, the letter S, for instance, looks different after a letter O than after letter A, and you can program that right into the font. A lot of the more basic ones, you know, you'll just get letter shapes. You might get some ability to space them. It depends on what you want. And of course, some of them will have you print out a form, send it back to the company with your credit card number, and they make it into the font and they try to make it look all nice. Some of them you just write on the screen. And that's what we'll do today. There is an app called FontSelf, fontself.com. FontSelf.com is one of these on-screen apps where you can pay to have it made from your own handwriting with all sorts of features. But they also make an iPad app under the same name where you can literally do it by starting from scratch. And they'll even give you templates to help out. You can see, you could draw a letter and decide for yourself how much of the template to follow. And we're going to do that. You can, and yes, they even put calligraphy pen choices in there. You can choose how your pen will look. Will it be fat? Will it be thin? Will it be more like a fountain pen or pencil, or more like a calligraphy pen? In other words, I like, when I'm doing fonts, I will pick something. I will often pick a template to help myself out, but you do have an option to do it totally blank.
Chrysalis has a reply to your earlier question.
Yes.
No. She says no.
Perhaps Chrysalis will tell me what she does one of these days, because whatever she does, if she's that perceptive on font, she's very good at it. Now, I'm going to see if I can.
Should I stop screen sharing, Kate?
I would say stop this because I'm trying.
Okay. Whoops. You seem to have lost Kate.
I haven't used StreamYard in about a month, plus my mind is a little disturbed because my mother passed on
recently,
a few weeks ago. Actually, you'll notice I took the jewelry off my hat because I wasn't going to wear big flashy jewelry after what happened. Now I'm looking for the I'm looking for the settings on this control because there is, here's a setting. Okay, camera. I'm trying to find how to invert the camera because there's supposed to be a way to do the settings, camera settings. Here's how we do. We're going to do front camera, going to turn it to back camera. Now I will want to see if this works. Okay, we got the camera. Great. Now you see, I am actually going to start a font. Now, since I'm using someone else's device, it doesn't have the fonts that are in progress that I've been making on my machine, but we're going to make my first font. Now I could start with a template or with a blank sheet. And just to show you, I could start with something that's basically very basic printed letters. I don't have to follow this exactly. That's the joy of this. This is handwriting. I could say, well, I want this A, but I want mine to be more pointy or more rounded or more something. And as you'll see, I will even get to pick. I can do something like this and change it. I could do, believe it or not, I could follow this and make changes. I may very well work with this because this is very similar to my own handwriting, but has some distinct differences. And I could even do this. And yes, you get to choose. You can have a regular or a calligraphy pen as your app, as your stylus. I am going to use an Apple Pencil. You're supposed to use an electronic stylus.
It looks like fractured, Kate.
Yeah, this one actually is. Now, I may not do this. Now, I was originally going to just do one font and get it done. But I decided on the way to the broadcast that it might be more fun to do a few letters in different styles to follow some of the templates and then maybe do one all on my own that's a blank. And those of you who are interested in fictional languages from science fiction series like, you know, Vogon or Dothraki or Elvish, you know, this is your chance, you know. But anyway, we can actually show little. I'm going, and I could actually draw with my finger. So why not? You know, as long as I'm, you know, having some fun with technology, let's see how it goes. I normally use an Apple Pencil, but if you can draw with your finger, let's see. Now, I don't want to start off with this. I'm going to take one. This is very close to my handwriting. Now, what am I going to do? I see settings. By the way, there's even a movie you can watch in this that tells you to do it. Let's put up cells in the grid just to give me some guidelines. See? Now, there's help. There is something. Now, watch here. Here is where my pens hang out, which are actually, I can have a brush. I can control size. And I'm just showing you all the fun before I even get started. Roundness of the brush. Is it pressure sensitive? For this style, I probably will not have it. And what is the angle? We can go for the 45. Use the pen direction. Well, I don't really want that. That will basically have input from the actual position of your hand, which is great if you're doing brush stroke show card writing. For those of us who love it and are good at it, I love to see it, but I'm not good at it. I could even streamline the strokes a little bit, you know. See, it basically smooths out the edges a little. I could do this, or I could, for a pencil, I get fewer choices, basically just size and streamlining. Or I could have calligraphy pen, very much like a brush, but of course, much, you know, more, we have a little more precision, a little more customization. So we can have size. We could have our, you know, roundness. In other words, how blobby is the stroke? Is it like a really crisp cut pen or more like a stub pen? Pressure. I probably don't want it. I am not someone who loves pressure sensitive strokes. I just don't do pressured, you know, pressure variations well. Again, we could go to anything. This is great for Hebrew writing. This is great for certain types of really medieval writing. But for this, which is tonight, today, we'll be doing a Renaissance hand. And let's leave it here. Now, we don't, unfortunately, get colors. We do have an eraser, by the way, and we do have an undo, and you can even set the letter and word spacing. You know, if I write it and it doesn't look the way I want it to look when I make it, I could go back and change the spacing. Let's leave what they give me. So I'm going to draw, of course, my first letter. I don't really like the fancy top on the A. Let's see, how is it, pen? Okie dokie. The size might be a little too big. Let's see how this goes. Now look, I can tilt it to an angle that's comfortable for me to write. I can literally tilt this. I can enlarge this. I can get dots to guide me, but let's try. Now this may not be perfect, but that doesn't matter because I could do it again. Besides, remember, I could do lots and lots of fonts. I could do like three fonts that were similar but different, have them all on, and every so often change a letter in one font to be in another so it did look all messed up, you know, all mixed up rather. Not messed up, we hope. By the way, you get sets of letters. This doesn't let you do like every single thing that would be in Unicode, but you can do all the capitals, all the lowercase, the numerals, punctuation, and some things like at signs. I'm going to do a B, and then I think I'm going to do probably one or two symbols. Now, I don't necessarily need the guidance. I'm going with this to show you that there's guidance. And by the way, if you think that this looks a little bit like someone learning to write, well, you're right. How many of you have kids that really should be practicing their handwriting? And they're really not, because they have much better things to do with their lives than sit down and write a letter 20 zillion times on some grid paper or some line paper and make sure that they get it exactly right. But if you tell them, hey, you can make your own font, if you know how you want those letters to look, you could go and get them exactly right, and we don't have to print it out and make your font till it's exactly right. A lot of people who don't want to sit in a workbook and write A, you know, will be perfectly willing to write letters as long as it takes to get their A. Now, notice here at the top of the screen, they actually give you a sentence. The quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog. And every time I work on a letter, it gets filled in that sentence. Mm. So you can actually see how it's going to look. And as I'm sticking to the template, because that will stick, you know, basically with the spacing they gave me, we might do a fun one, but I want to go do with some other letters. Now watch this. If I suspect that somewhere hiding in there might be, you know, there might be another sample that would let me see lowercase, but I haven't found how to activate that. Oh my God, it comes up. Now, here's the thing. I made a dot, and this was not good. So that's okay. I can undo. And now I'm going to go and now we're going to fill in this part, and I'm not going to do everything. I want to see if I can sort of hack a little bit of joining by maybe extending the tail of the A out. You know, it actually looks as if it would join. I don't want it more than that because here the next letter is a Z. This might be even too much. But suppose I had something like, you know, animal or something. Actually, I might make this a little less. Let's see. Look at this. I can erase and still have a perfect calligraphy pen line. Now, I am not crazy about the variant of, oh gosh, this thing turned off. I don't know. I hit something and don't. Okay, I'm going to take this away from the screen because I can't let people see the passcode. Okay. All right. But I happen to not like the particular, I don't like, at least not for my own handwriting, the particular, you know, version of the ascenders that, hey, why is this not going? You know, that actually has that curve. So note, I have this. Now I'm thinking, yeah, this is good. It might be a little too slanted, or I haven't gotten too far. I might decide to make the stroke wider. I don't know that I can, I don't think I can retroactively do that. No, you can't. In some of these apps, you can actually select a stroke and then go and change it. And by the way, you know, but let's see, I'm just going to do C. I figured do three letters, symbols, what have you. Going to take advantage of the fact that I can turn this, you know. Why not make it easy on the old wrists? Oops, I don't want that, you know. Sometimes I don't remember that you have to go. Now, this, let's see. Oh, I don't want that. That's the only thing that I see. I could do this. Let's please, please, please. I don't want to do this. I'm trying to shrink this. Well, this is just, let's see if we can, let's see. Well, here's what I'm going to do. By the way, when I started making it, it gave it a name, My Cool Font. I don't know yet if one can change the names, but that's okay. Now let's go. I figured let's do something else. Let's see. Numbers. We've got some numbers and some punctuation. You actually see that I could have scrolled down instead of changing from area to area. But as long as we're here, let's do zero, one, two. Now I'm going to do this, but I'm going to do something. I figure I normally write a zero like this, but this is not really what pleases me. Let me make this bigger so I can see what I'm doing. Now, normally I do write a zero quite like this, but I think for this font, it might be fun to do the old cross zero. Believe it or not, you do sometimes see those even in the Renaissance, some of the odd numeral variations we have today. Okay, that's just business meeting that, don't worry, is probably not going to happen anyway, so don't worry. Okay, guy has had some changes in schedule. So I figure I could actually take this out later, but I'm putting it in. So I might take this out before I make it a finished font. I just wanted to show you, you know, that this actually existed. You don't see it often, but you do see it sometimes even back then. This is my typical one. Oopsie, that is not it. I'm going to actually do a few more. I might do all the numerals because there are not many. Now, two, I don't like to start so low. Let's have a little coolness here. Now for three, I like to do a rather more old-fashioned type of three. I like to do some of the old-fashioned character sets for numbers where they actually had ascenders and descenders. My particular habit has been to do 0, 1, and 2, the same height as a short letter, then give all the odd numbers descenders and give all the even numbers ascenders. This is not quite as precise as I would like. So let's try it again. You know, I have sometimes considered, I don't like where that stroke is. Let's go over here. I have sometimes I've considered crossing the top of the four, you know, closing at the top, sometimes not. This is good, but this stroke looks a little weak because as a diagonal with a calligraphy pen, it's weak. So let's try this again. Let's go for a more vertical one and let's change the proportions. It's good, but it's a little too teensy weensy. Let's go really. Well, I don't want that. Let's go. I'm trying to stick with the spacing for now. This is not bad. Okay. I probably won't do all the punctuation, although punctuation can be fun. And if you ever thought that quotation marks or something in something you were reading looked abominable, this is where you get to have, that's a little too high. I'm wondering if there's a selection tool. No. Some of the fancier ones actually have a select tool where you can take something that's out of place and it's not quite right either. Where you can take something that's out of place and move it up or down. Now, I don't really like that. 6, with all its curves, is one of the harder ones for me and always has been. I think this has a little bit of flair. Let's go with that. 7, if you want, you can get your crossed 7s, which have a long and venerable history. I used to write them when I was a teenager trying to find ways to make my writing look cool. Now I don't, but I will do this just a little one. Mm-hmm. You know, years ago, when I gave handwriting lessons to the MDs, before the electronic prescriptions came in, one thing that I often did was many of the people, this is a little too flamboyant, many of the people that I worked with, I don't really like this, learned to cross a 7, and it was very hard for them to stop, even though they knew that their 7s were being misread either as cursive Fs or people didn't know what they were, you know, and you couldn't get them to stop. What I did was I simply told them, you like the 7, it doesn't look to you like a 7 without. It bothers a lot of people here where they just don't know what it is. Keep that 7, keep that little stroke, but make it as small as you can just to satisfy yourself that you've got a 7, you know? And then, of course, if you really decide that you, you know, you really, really have to get rid of even a stroke. You might not decide this. No reason you have to. This is small enough that, Americans know it's a 7. The stroke is small enough. But if you want to write the typical kind for some reason, you can simply tell yourself each day to make that stroke a little smaller than the last. And then you'll end up eventually with nothing and you'll be fine. I actually got the idea, that idea, from a friend of mine who used to be a cigarette smoker and he needed to quit for medical reasons. And he worked out the easiest way to quit because he didn't have the money to go to those programs where they, you know, put electric shocks under your fingernails, which I understand they can't do anymore. It's illegal. Or they give you a drug that makes you throw up every time you smoke, or they show you horrible movies of lung cancer, or they have you in a support group. He didn't have the money at the time. So he made up a reasonable way. He was a chain smoker. He was selling like a pack and a half a day. So he simply made a rule that he was going to smoke as many cigarettes as he wanted every day. But every day he had to start smoking at a later hour and minute than he had on the previous day. His normal habit had been to just get up at 4:30 a.m. and just reach for that pack and light up and puff away, puff his way through his day. So, you know, the first day he was a bit of an early riser, got up at 4:30. Well, next day he couldn't do that. But 4:31, he waited till the digital clock said 4:31 and there, puff, puff, puff. You know, next day he was obviously a little later. After some time, there started to be from longer intervals, you know, before that first cigarette of the day. And at some point, he was down to a point where his first cigarette of the day was 11 p.m. And then his first cigarette of the day was 11, you know, 40 p.m. at some point. And then a little after that, it was 11:59 p.m. Well, okay. So he couldn't have, he was down to one cigarette a day and then it was none. And he had tapered off. And that's what I say. If you have something in your letter that is an extra, extra shape and you want to, like, let's say you're someone who has it. Let's say I've seen people, I'm going to erase this for a minute. And I've seen people came in who had a very fancy 7 or a very fancy anything else. You know, I've seen people come in and they have like, I don't want to tell you what doctor did that, but don't worry, he wasn't my doctor. But I've seen things that, you know, people doing this. I say, okay, if you can't stand to leave out those little twiddly widdlies, make them smaller and smaller, and you'll get down to something reasonable before you know it. Now on to 8. This is an interesting matter of what many people call ductus, and I call it the pen path, simply the stroke order and direction of one's writing. You know, here in the USA, there's more than one way of doing a number 8. Some of us are taught to basically do it like drawing Frosty the Snowman, which is very accident prone, but it's nice if we can do it right. A lot of us cannot do it right, or we can do it, but it collapses at speed. Okay? Most of us are taught and to do basically an S and go back to the beginning, which usually works pretty well. I like to have this little divot on the end of it, this little exit serif, mainly because a lot of type fonts have it, even some typewriter fonts, but I think we need to make the middle a little stronger. This is not 8 because of all its curves can be difficult. One day I will actually do an episode on theories of how numeral shapes were invented in various countries. There actually is a theory that the 8 may have originated as 2 diamonds, you know, 4-cornered diamonds, one on top of the other, 4 plus 4. Leave this aside, I'm not crazy about this because I want that stroke to be a little less. This is probably good. I will fix it later. Now, what's interesting, though, before I go and fix this, in many parts of the world, the stroke orders and directions, the pen paths were numeral. For some numerals and some letters are different. Most of the people from Southeast Asia, India, and neighboring countries with whom I work, well, quite a lot of them, I say 50 or 60% of them, they are taught to actually do an 8, you know, like this, where it starts somewhere on the equator and it ends somewhere on the other side of the equator. It actually works pretty well. I can't get myself to do it. I think it's a good shape, but the problem is, when you speed up a letter form, if it's sped up in a way that the other person doesn't expect because his stroke orders or her stroke orders are different, then it may not be understood. In other words, if my sloppiest 8 is like this, and someone in India's sloppiest state is like this, it may not be obvious to either of us what the other is doing. Mm-hmm. And this, of course, is important, not just in the Roman alphabet or with Roman or with our numerals, the global numerals, the Arabic numerals, as they're often called, which is a term I don't use because the actual numerals used for Arabic are way different. So when times when I've had Arab students in my class, I learned very quickly they would not accept me calling it Arabic numerals. So I settled for calling them the global numerals. Everyone was happy. And of course, those of us who study Chinese or Japanese know that if you write a character with the wrong stroke order, it probably can't be read because you'll be writing rapidly and something will not just be out of place, but it'll be out of place in a way that the other person does not expect. I have to tell you, I have never found an 8 that satisfies me, some of them in a type font, some of them 99%. I guess this is probably good. 9, I'm one of these rare people who like to do my 9s the way the type font and the typewriter does them. I like to do this instead of doing this. I think this is good if you can do it, but it's a little bit weak looking. It's a little accident prone. I say, I like to do this.
Yeah, okay. It's beautiful.
Thank you very much. You know, I think it's a little easier to control. It doesn't risk being mistaken for a Q or G in alphanumerics. Now, this 8, I would like to actually make it a little taller, which is the way I typically do them when I do them. That looks much better. And I'm going to leave this little gap. I mean, I'm human. I'm not a robot. Now we can go. We can have punctuation marks. No particular reason to do it, except I might as well do a numeral sign because it's a hashtag. And people think it's so boring and not fun to do. Here is the fun way to do a hashtag and make it look beautiful. Instead of going down, down, across, across, go down, across, down, across. Ta-da! Oh. And of course, if I wanted a little small one, like a superscript, I could do it. Now, you know, I'm just going to retouch this. I could have done it. Sometimes I've been known to do this, but too many people confuse it for like just some symbol or something. So I don't do it unless it's absolutely clear that this is for a numeral anyway. Well, I can have this. Now, this font is not entirely done, but we're going to do another one. We have some fractured English. We have some cool graffiti. We have some basic printing. Let's go for this, you know. And there are lots of variants of the black letter. This is a very simplified fractur, which appears to be based on Rudolf Koch's Neuland, which is a beautiful font, but which this, whoever did this, has absolutely wrecked by deciding he should put it in all capitals. You know, unlike the Unschel style that is a remote ancestor of this, you know, most black letter fonts really do not look that great when they're in all capitals. They just have a little too much decoration. You know, for much the same reason that our conventional cursive does not look good in all capitals or the more, you know, designy, the more elaborate type fonts do not. You know, I will tell you, I mean, he gets away with this. You know, whoever designed this probably didn't realize too late that was a little bit off. I mean, basically, the only place this looks good is if you're like advertised Oktoberfest and you want to advertise, you know, here is a place where you just suck up, you know, various, intoxicating German beers and get, you know, drunk out of your skull, you know, yeah. It looks okay for that. You know, this is like, you know, this looks okay for Oktoberfest or for your local, you know, German countryside themed bar. For most purposes, it does not. Anyway, don't worry. I probably should have put on, you know, do not disturb. Someone's angry at my husband whose tablet this is. Well, he can find out in the morning. Don't worry. Most of his friends are nice, so I have no particular reason. I might as well put on do not disturb because we really should not see this. Hey, Siri, enable do not disturb. Oh, he doesn't have Siri voice activated. We'll do it. Oh, did you know you can type to Siri now if you want to? We used to talk with her.
I did not know that.
Yeah, that is actually in the current version of the software. And you don't even need to, yeah. And that can be very handy if you're in a public place and, you know, Besides, I'm not sure Siri recognizes my voice. Oh, it's, I don't think it's enabling Do Not Disturb. Let's go. Let's do the settings. It probably doesn't understand because they didn't capitalize or something. That's okay. I'm going to do Do Not Disturb and then put it back. Do Not Disturb is now in a part of the app called Focus, which gives you lots of choices. I probably should have done this before, but I didn't really remember, that he didn't have this on. Okay. So now we're not going to hear from people, who want to talk to my husband or who are angry or want to thank him, or whatever it might be. Let's get back to some serious fonting here. And definitely I'm going to go take this. I'm going to make, let's make a bigger pet. Yeah. This ought to be good. I'm going to make a little bit flatter pen angle, not by much, but I'm even going to make a little flatter, not too much flatter, little flatter than this has, because I just want to make it a little bit more dramatic. Come on, I don't want that. Okay, we're going to go, come on. I'm going to expand this. I want to see if I can get those cells, get those grids. It's just helpful for me now. Gonna show you a little something. Most of us, when we learn to write, have learned to do an A by doing the left, the right, and the middle. Actually, a historically older way of doing it is left, middle, right, which, as you probably saw in the other A example, is what I do in my own handwriting. Let's, bulk this up a little bit. This is sort of a cross between black letter and, graffiti. That's okay. I could actually make it fancy. Those decorative thin lines they have in the black letter. Well, I'm going to memorize these settings because I want to get back to them. What I'm going to do is I'm going to change the angle to be this way, and I'm going to do one of these things, which we've sometimes seen, Okay. See, I can actually change it much more easily than picking up a pen. So you can even have negative angles, which are cool for things like, for Hebrew, for some of the, Asian scripts. But let's go to, I'm going to go in. Now that's not really placed where I would like it. How about, come on. No, I want to place this where I want it to be. Yeah. Just have something a little, that's a little too crazy, but I wanted to get the sort of, let's get that, some of that old English Robin Hood vibe or that medieval German castle vibe. If I was doing the whole set, I would actually do it on all the letters. But for now, I'm just going to do it. I'm just going to do it here. I could, by the way, I'm wondering if I get a choice of color. I actually do get other tools. I get a, I'm wondering. Yeah, I might tell them that I might want some extra brush styles. We'll do that later once I know this app a little better. There are some that will let you have multicolored pens so you can, which are great if you're doing emoji or if you're doing colored letters. One thing they're good for is if you're making fonts where the fonts are like for images and like you want to have, like suppose I wanted to have, and this is one thing I hope to one day do, a font that would be for children, for beginners, where instead of the ABC, the lowercase a might be an apple with a lowercase a superimposed on the outside of the apple. And I might do something like make the apple in the actual colors of the apple, but then make the lowercase a thick and black. But to get back to our little fun with Ductus, or as I call it, pen path, because I would prefer to stick to plain English, I'm going to do some little sketches in here. A lot of people don't realize that if you have your A in this way, that's your archaic Greek A, which was, of course, your Phoenician Aleph. So yeah. You have A, you have Alpha. A lot of people don't realize, and they'll tell you stories like, and the Greeks had the Phoenician Aleph, and they turned it upside down and this way and that way. They didn't. They just changed how they were going from the first stroke to the second stroke. It took many
years. Can you do that again? I want to say that again.
Left, middle, right. And if you do it this way, it's so easy. It feels weird at first because you're not used to it. But I will challenge you, if you go home and you write 20 capital A's left, middle, right, and then you write 20 of them the way that you used to do them, you know, left, right, middle, this has more motion involved. You have to do more motion, because what is it really, left, right? You're doing almost like an extra step, and it's one more thing to be accident prone. And of course, when we look at some of the other Roman hands, like the, you know, late rustic hand, you see this and you think, oh, the A is not crossed. Sure, it's crossed. It's just left, middle, right. Just the crossbar was done here by someone literally cutting corners. And if you've ever wondered why the A looks as it is, now you know. Now let's clean it up. It shouldn't be all over my nice, clean, you know, font work. Or, well, I hope this is nice, clean. And by the way, similar things apply to the H. I figure as long as we're having fun with ductus, B, C, D, let's have some fun with D and then go to the lowercase, right? Okay. We don't have to do, so let's say we're going to do our D, and this is, this is sort of a bastardo, which is basically, which at one point was an early Renaissance, late medieval hand that was sort of a conglomeration. In other words, imagine you put black letter and you put early Renaissance Roman into a blender and turned on the blender. So you can see why it was named what it was named. Now to go for a minute though, I erased it. No problem. Get it right back. Let's go down. Now look at this. Now has anyone, oh, I don't want this. I'm trying to just expand.
Oh,
like
yeah.
A monkey wrench, you know?
That's a Jean Lafitte D.
Yeah. Now that's like, that kind of D existed for a long time, even in some very, even in some very recent books, and even in some 18th century and early 19th century cursive styles, you will see it. And by the way, this is important. Why did I do D? Not just because it's a fun letter, because it gives us a little sense of history. If you have ever wondered how come the capital D has its stomach pointing this way, you know, or it's curved, let's be and the lowercase D has its stomach, you know, like, was this invented by someone who decided, I will torture all dyslexic people, all people who cannot tell their left from their right. I will make their lives miserable. Well, not at all. I would like, of course, to turn down the size a little just so they can have room to fit what I'm going to fit in here. This is a D, Roman era D. This is a D somewhat later, and this is a D, and this is a D, and this is a D, and this, oops, let's go make the end. So let's do this one and this one, and now you not only know this is how we got a D, but you even know why, even in cursive styles of the sort that have loops in the ascenders, they very, very rarely loop the D. And why not? Because when you do a D like this, you're not going to want to make it that tall. You're going to make it rather short. You're going to, and let's go, I'm going to give you, that one was not so great, but let me give you Jean Lafitte's or similar. Well, not his exactly, not he, but right? You might want to make a curve, but you won't make it as tall as, let's say, an L would be. And for other reasons, the T likewise is, you know, conventionally and traditionally shorter. We can get into the T later. We should probably do an episode on letter history, which would tie in a nice way with my book. But today we're doing a little, you know, taste of that. In other words, for a long time, if the handwriting book had, let's say you had the word old, and let's say I'm going to try to imitate for a moment, really, you know, let's say it's something like this in, you know, the year, you know, 1800 or something. Okay. Or actually, let's say better D would have been something like this would have been more common. Well, it's not quite as tall. You see, the L is a little taller. And this means that even once people said, well, let's make the D the same as all the other ascenders, it's sort of weird going off on its own like that. So if they had, well, you know, if they had, well, since you were talking about Jean Lafitte, let's write the word gold. If he had something like this, You know, he would not have had something like this. He would have had something like, okay, I want to make it gold.
He would actually be writing in French.
He would be writing French. I suspect he knew some English, but I'm using this as an example, simply because the French word for gold does not have a D in it. So you can see making it big didn't look that great, but gold, but then you might say, this doesn't really fit. But if you're used to the D being shorter than the other letters, then you will do it. And in fact, some models of cursive, as we know it, still have that shorter D. One or two of them have only very recently changed just because someone said, well, why make it shorter? And the fact was, it was a little like those vestigial organs. You know, when you learn that people or animals have some organs that at one point had a job and now they don't. Like, if you think of human beings, you know, why do we get goosebumps when we are cold or frightened? Because if you're something with hair, like a chimpanzee or, you know, a dog or a cat, that particular state of your skin will cause your fur to puff up, get you warmer, and make you look bigger to scare away whatever bigger creature is scaring you. And if you're human, you've still got the same muscles that do this, but since our hair is nothing on 90% of our bodies, it doesn't do a thing. It just happens. And this is, in a way, what happened with the D. I mean, not that all D's were short, you know, from the Renaissance on and even earlier. You know, if in the Renaissance, the taller and the shorter D's were competing. In earlier times, they were also competing. Today, the taller one appears to have won out. Now, there are lots of things I could do here, but let's look at some of our, we can look at some of our other templates. You know, I could look at this graffiti one. I really am not crazy about that kind of writing, but there are people who like it. But I figured you can all even do one where it just gives you guidelines. You can just get, you know, you can just get lines and just, you know, like roll your own. I don't know if I'm confident enough to do it, but literally I'm going to go and let's say I like my capitals to not be as tall as my ascenders. I decide I'm going to do something cool. Why not do something like this? You know, I can go and do some nice, I could do some very nice display lettering or even some not so nice display lettering. I don't know. Do I like that? Maybe. Ooh, let's go. Look, we were going medieval. Yeah, let's really get some medieval, you know. You can do this. You could do this. You could, you know, I could do an alphabet with just fancy capitals and mix that in with a plainer alphabet so that I could have decorative capitals. And I've even seen people do alphabets where, let's say, okay, I want to erase this. You know, this is not going to be obviously my completed font, but just to show you what is possible to do, you could do an alphabet that was only meant for decorative capitals and that you were only using then, and you could go and do this and print it in your favorite color. And you could do, this is admittedly quite hasty, but I think that some of us have seen, I could have some fun here. A is for arch, you know. Mm-hmm. You could do a lot of, you could have something, you could do your favorite. You want your medieval, you want your Elvis, you want your Game of Thrones. I don't know if they have an alphabet. Well, I'm not going to engage in this particular little thing that K, I want to just, they don't have unlimited undos, although you do get quite a lot. Now, one thing you can do is, of course, with a blank paper, you just, you know, write whatever the heck you want, but you could do some fun. We might want, I'm going to suggest extra font templates, but I could go to something that doesn't have, you know, just gives me some spacing. And this basically shows me units of height. It just gives me, you know, a little more. I might decide, now I do not know what necessarily are keyboard assignments for other writing systems that have alphabets, but I could have some fun. We were talking about Phoenician before. What if I go and change to a pen that looks a little, I want to get something that looks a little less round. I'm not really interested in, I'm going to try to see if I can, I could actually go and I could actually Let's see if I can go size, thickness. Let's see what I can do about the angle. I could use this one. I could go and do a fairly decent Hebrew. I can do much better than that. That is not, that is, but note this, they actually call this one kalam, as in the pen that's used for scripts like Arabic and Urdu, which I do not know how to write anything in Arabic. I could, but for those who do, it's there. I mean, basically, I can write, you know, letters, you know, but I don't know what they mean. Like, this is going to be total gibberish, you know, but I could actually do the shapes, you know. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to see if I can take a moment. I want to go onto the internet. I want to see if I can get what the word halal, which is the Muslim equivalent of kosher food, looks like in Arabic, because I've seen that on signs. I know what it looks like. I can't copy it, but I've seen it on a lot of, you know, store signs around here. So what does the Arabic word halal look like in Arabic? Yep. Let's see. Come on. I hate when it just erases me. What does the Arabic word halal look like in Arabic? Come on, please behave for me now. Yeah, I just didn't. Okay, we're going to get an image. Okay, now I want to see if I can open the app. This app is not letting me open it. I'm going to have to see if I can remember how this looks, because I'm going to pick some fairly simple. I'm going to try to remember how this looks, and I don't think I can remember how this looks. Oh, actually, I'd have an easier time writing haram, which is the opposite, which is forbidden, you know? But yeah. I don't know how easy a time I have, but I'm trying to trace this with my finger, and you know, because you could even use these for logos. You could have I can't even remember it, but I can remember that the first letter going right to left is like this. Look, I could learn it. Arabic is not an alphabet, I know, but you know, you could actually take a font and make your favorite, you know, logotypes, as it's called. In other words, you could make a font where you could have, we could write several words. I could decide that, you know, I don't necessarily want to do it, but I could decide if I had a font with more character spaces that of or something. Horrible version of, I'm not going to do this. But anyway, as long as you're doing a first letter, since I mentioned ancient Phoenician, ta-da, Aleph, ancient Phoenician, nice. The root of ours, I am probably a little better at this than at the Arabic. When I was young, for a time when I was in my preteen years, I actually used this as secret code for my diary. This is probably wrong, but I'm trying to do it, you know, because mm-hmm. I mean, I was writing in English, but basically was substituting, you know, these letters, and I'm sure my pen path is all wrong, substituting these, you know, and of course having extra letters for ones that didn't, no, that is all terrible, you know, for ones that, you know, just didn't exist and were needed for English. So basically had these and a bunch of extras, and I was writing right to left, but it was in English, not any attempt at phonetic transcription, just spelled out letter by letter, basically a secret code for my diary. Now, this, of course, cannot make it go left to right. Most word processors have a function that can. I am not going to strain your patience. I think I'm going to go up to F, which would have been Vav, and that's it. Probably a different pen choice would be better. But if you want to do something, if you want to do your favorite font from your favorite ancient
I would love to do, Kate, I don't know if there's like a really simple way to do, but you know, they have the entire Old Testament online.
Yeah.
Text. I would like to have it just automatically rewritten in the ancient Hebrew.
Oh, that's simple. You know what? You can get the file. it's a text file, the entire Hebrew scripture, and you can get fonts. There actually are fonts that are made that are Phoenician or Paleo Hebrew, and these are actually made for people, you know, who are teaching archaeology courses or writing in archaeology magazines, and at some point they may want to type a word. They may want to say, this is how the word was spelled in this inscription, as opposed to the way it was spelled by most people. And sometimes they do it. Now, I think you learn any writing system better by writing it by hand, but there are enough uses for this. There actually are companies that make fonts of literally every ancient civilization or script that you have ever heard of, and some that you haven't. Fonts of ancient civilizations and languages. And look, I saw why I don't have to search with this improvised search term, because I saw something came up. Fonts, ancient scripts. Okay. Now watch this. Unicode fonts for ancient scripts. Look, they've got Akkadian, Sumerian, hieroglyphs, Coptic, Cretan hieroglyphs, you know, you name it. Look how many of the companies do this. Here are some. Look at this. Okay, you want to be an ancient Egyptian scribe without spending 20 years learning how to, you know, we've got, these are Byzantine era musical notation, which I've seen with you. Yeah, they had way different musical notation. So these are handy. Like, imagine you're doing a movie and it's set in, you know, the Eastern Roman Empire in, you know, a monastery and covers, I don't know, murder in the church choir. You know, you could have a close-up of their music book. Raslani ancient script font. I'm not sure what language this is from, but this is, okay, this is alphabet and Unicode. Look at this. Look at this. I mean, they've got, I mean, they not only have that, but they even threw in, okay, what have they got? Okay, they've got a pretty decent font for Latin. Now, at the top looks like a plain old Roman font, but look, they have metrical quantity symbols over the syllables. This is a font that someone made to actually mark the rhythmic patterns of poetry if someone was, you know, showing how Latin. Next one, okay, is Greek. Under that, looks like Greek. It's actually the early Anglo-Saxon script. Not runes, but the ones they had. Under that, they have an IPA, International Phonetic Alphabet, used by phoneticians, linguists, and even people who learn to sing opera in foreign language. Under this is Old Church Slavonic. And someone had to make these by hand. Under that, this is Hebrew.
It's Assyrian Aramaic.
Yeah, well, we call it the Hebrew script today, okay. But, you know, but this is, for those who are curious, this is the first sentence in the Bible. So, okay. Under that I would like to say Gothic, but people today use Gothic as a synonym for the fractured black letter. The actual Gothic was way older and was from a nation that is now extinct. Under this, we have Devanagari, the script of Sanskrit, and so many others. I'm just pointing out the ones, you know, this one, I don't know, like, them to read them, but I can recognize them the way you recognize the language you've heard. Because let me close up on this one. This one is Etruscan. Under this, we have Olam, which people think is pronounced Ogham, O-G-H-A-M, but it's pronounced Olam, the script of the ancient Druids of Ireland. Under this, I've seen this. I don't know what it's called. It's pretty, it's getting hard to sort of, I'm trying to focus. I'm going to make that one be the top line. You can't really see it. It's sort of got to pull out. I don't know what that is. I've seen it, but I don't know what it is. Next one is cuneiform, probably either for Sumerian. I don't know which cuneiform was used to write many languages. This one, I don't know what it is. Again, it's something I've seen. Ditto for the one under that. The one under that is Glagolitic, what was used in Russia in the days immediately pre-Cyrillic. And the one under this, again, it's something I've seen, but I don't know. So look, I'm pretty sure that someone in there has got a font. Oh, now this is cool. The same people who did this even did handwriting fonts for ancient Roman era scripts. That really messy looking one about six lines down, that's actually early Roman cursive, illegible today except to specialists. And whoever did this actually did his chart, did this chart. Here's a much, I want to show a much clearer version. Okay, there's that one. I'm looking for the other
Okay,
one.
Kate, at this point, we really are not seeing most of your screen.
Oh, that's a shame. See, I'm trying to make this work, okay? I'm trying to make this work. Thank you for letting me know because let me go in. I'm trying to enlarge this. This one is such a blurry representation. This one, what this guy did, he actually arranged, he or she, whoever did this, actually arranged some of his handwritten fonts or hers to create a history of the Roman alphabet. Okay, going this way, you've got your own personal time machine. This part took us all the way from early, from ancient Rome, classical Rome, to the very early Renaissance. And now but you wanted Paleo Hebrew Phoenician. I'm pretty sure I'm going to find you that because that way you'll be able to get off and find it, and you'll make your own, which will be cooler because you'll be able to say that this was made by a modern day descendant of those same peoples. So let's go and find Proto-Hebrew, Proto-Sinaitic, Paleo-Hebrew, Canaanite, Phoenician fonts. I probably mispronounced Sinaitic because I am just tired at this hour, you know? Okay, it exists. There you go. Feast your eyes if you want this. And by the way, okay, we've got everything, including
Okay, show us the link
what?
and yeah, the
I'm going to show
URL.
you the link on this. Let's show you the link. I can do better than I'm going to show you the link to the search. And what I'm going to do is the easiest way for me to show you the link to the search is to pretend that I was going to mail you. And it's a big, long link. I don't want to mail you, but that's okay because I can take off the part that's just formatting. And this way we'll be able to, if I take off the ampersand and everything after that, come on. I don't, this way. Okay, now I'm going to go. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to stretch out my screen, and there, if you take a screenshot, you can just read that.
Oh, that's okay. That's fine because we do have a recording. We have it recorded.
Great. Okay, fine. I keep forgetting this can record. And if you need a font like this, I mean, technically, all fonts or almost all fonts really are handwriting fonts because someone did them by hand, but often it was with a lot of retouching. You saw me write them and just write them. Okay. So believe me, if it exists, there is probably a font of it. And if there is not a font of it, you can make a font of it. Now, I'm wondering if we have anyone else who might have a request for me to do a particular font. Actually, I'm going to go back to this while I wait for requests because I like to go, come on, let's, I want to go do this and I happen to like, the other kind of a. Let me get my settings back to where I should like them to be. Get back to that calligraphy pen and let's go take this. I don't think I want any roundness. I think this will be good.
So, do any viewers have a request for Kate?
In other words, and if it's something I know how to write, I will try to do it. If not, you're out of luck, but remember, you can get any of these. I'm going to go do
Now,
my
Kate,
little.
you did have your screen much more it centered, so
I did,
before.
but I'm trying to do something. I wanted to do something and get it right before I showed you. And
Oh, okay.
this is really not, in other words, I was saying, let's do this. By the way, I'm going to go do your little, just writing, let's have some fun doing Hebrew letters here. We don't have to. And, you know, and we don't have to, but at least we can. I wanted to put in a somewhat decorative, nah, this does not really add to it. But I just thought I would put in an A. And the reason for some reason, this is, see, that's the cool font. I can change the names of these. I'm given to understand when I upload them. You know, in other words, I've got these. After this, I will ask Andy if he wants me to finish any of them. And if he does, I'll finish it and it gets to be his. I'm obviously not going to upload partial fonts, but since no one volunteered a font, I might as well make some really wacky type of, no, I don't want to do that. I want to make some wacky type of font. Let me get my templates. I can actually, for some of these, you know, this is blank. For some of them, a template character is built in. I'm trying to think of something. I sort of do a ransom note font, you know, with every letter in a different style, as if it was cut out of a paper, but I think that's rather tacky. So let's see what I could. Okay, we got a marker. I don't really want that. We're going to go. I like something where I can control what it's doing. We're going to go take a route. I want to try something like, okay, if I want to do an A, I'm trying to think of some kind of super, bizarre A, and I can't really think of anything. This is an extraordinarily bad taste. You know, I mean, this is like sort of how not to be a historical calligrapher, you know? Uh-huh. But I figure this is going to be like, when I get to name it, I'll probably call it my bad calligraphy alphabet. Well, we could have that, or if this is going to be bad, let's make it right. Yeah, this is terrible. Now, I don't know if I like this. Well, I have always toyed with the idea of doing an intentionally illegible font, you know, call it the, I don't want to slander doctors. My sister is a doctor, but, you know, some people would call this the doctor handwriting script, but, you know, let's do one that would be okay. In other words, I'm going to do, this is what happens when cursive goes bad. It's going to be the baddest, worst. No, I have to make this bad. I am sort of sick of sort of phony Gothic, so I'm going to make this like the deliberately alphabet of handwriting mistakes. What not to do if you insist on writing in cursive. Really bad. You know, I might have a use for this someday. Actually, capitals are hard to almost to make bad enough. Let's go look at lowercase. Oh, yeah. Yo, lowercase cursive can be a mess. Oh, that's not bad enough. Let's make it really bad. Yeah. Yeah, that's bad. That's bad. Okay, you know, I used to have this horrible handwriting, and now it's like I can't write bad if I try. Now, this is what I call this little puppy. Let's do a really bad version of it, is what I call the cheater's IE. And why I call it that is this is the part of cursive that people take advantage of if they don't know how to spell. And they have a spelling test and they have to write the word belief, let's say. And they don't remember if it's IE or EI, but they're writing in cursive so they go in like, I'm going to go do this. So they're like, what? And I'm going to write all over my font area, which is like terribly bad. So they write B-E-L. Diary, And they will simply assume, okay, if the teacher is gullible enough, she'll give this the benefit of the doubt. Of course, if she's a smart teacher, she'll say, if I can't read it, I assume it's the wrong one. So, okay. Now, if you want a really messed up letter, if you want to mess up a letter, the one, okay, G is, it's hard to make bad. A, you know, you can make it bad, but it's not. And of course, I.
Yeah.
You know, in some font apps, you can copy and paste.
Yeah, we don't have to continue to try to do bad stuff.
You don't have to, definitely. Why torture the alphabet anymore? But I wanted to show you, if you need something for bad handwriting, if you need that for some purpose in some graphic or some text you're writing, you might not be able to find deliberately bad handwriting, and you can make your own. And keep in mind, people who make these sometimes sell them or license them. So, anything else? Do we have any more comments?
We do not, you know, other than Chris Alyssa's comments from before. But what I'd like to see at this point,
I don't
care that you haven't finished any of the fonts.
Neither
do I. Choose one that you added some letters to, save it, and then show us how you can use your keyboard or whatever to.
Well, that's what I was going to do. Not next month, because I think we have something else planned, unless we don't. If we don't, I can do that next month. If we have something else planned, it will be for further on. Now, if you could remind me what we've got planned for next month.
I don't have that right in front of me, but I thought we did have a plan, but we could rearrange it.
We could. I was thinking, if I'm correct, I was wondering if we might do things like handwriting, calligraphy, parody songs. If my mom hadn't passed, I was thinking of moving this ahead, but she passed. And I am not going to be on camera singing happy songs less than a month after she left from us. She had a very hard time near the end. I believe next month I would like to do those basically.
Yeah,
you know,
I think
not
that
just
was
for
the
fun,
plan.
But because I think of them as teaching songs. Some of the songs that I know and some of those that I have written, I have actually, you know, used instructionally. In fact, I was actually writing a song today, not singing it, but working out the lyrics. And I was thinking, well, next month we could definitely do this. Some of the songs will be from a published collection by someone I used to know who has passed, I found out. Some of them, well, one or two of them will be songs of my own. I'll try to think of some cool name for this, and I might call it Scribe Songs, but I'll see if I can think of something cooler. Okay, we'll go with Scribe Songs because one of the books that I will be, the book that I will be using will actually be, was actually called Songs of the Scribe. I once wrote down some lyrics as a sort of draft and called some lyrics of my own Songs of Pendum, but frankly, those weren't very good. So if I can find some I think are good, we might do those. Meanwhile, keep in mind that you could have something like this, and you could actually designate some punctuation character that you don't use a lot to have your monogram, you know, instead of whatever it was supposed to have. For instance, here is a tilde. You may not write any language that it might be that you don't write any language that has a tilde or that you don't use it. And what if you made something like that be your monogram, which could sign your letters in your favorite font? I'm going to see if I can do a monogram for Aya Katz. And in fact, I might do two. I might do one with our conventional Roman alphabet that we use every day. And I might see if it's possible to do a Paleo Hebrew monogram and maybe even a, you know, present day Hebrew alphabet monogram. So let's see, what could I do with my cats? Do you like this?
Yeah, well, you know that I actually have a signature on my paintings.
That I did not notice. Okay, so I didn't mean to steal.
No, I mean it looks like the upside down A, kind of with a K sticking out of it.
Interesting. So, okay, now certainly you can have this. You know, it'll be in the recording if you want an alternate. I don't know if I'm that happy with it. Let's try. How about this? Nah. But that gets me close to what I'd love to do. Let's see if we can fill this with ancient Phoenician. Obviously going.
We have a comment from California Mountain Art and Life. And okay, she says, I love Kaya's signature.
Uh-huh. Well, I'd love to see that. By the way, this is my attempt at a Paleo Hebrew Phoenician monogram for you. Uh-huh. Aleph for Ayah, Kuf for cats.
Well, it's not Kuf. It's Kaf.
It's a Kaf. Oh, okay. Then I'm wrong. Then I have to redo it. Okay.
Yeah, did you know? Spelling do you know what Hebrew is?
Yeah. Cohen said it. You know what?
Yeah. Okay. Do you know what Kaf?
Yeah.
Hey, do you know what Kat stands for? It's an anagram. I mean, it's
Kohen Sedek, which yes. I should actually know. My father was a Kohen. I knew it, but you know, it didn't come. I had been assuming that it might be that your name might have been the Yiddish for cat, which is Kat.
No, so, it is not.
So in that case, well, you see, I've just corrected it for you.
Yeah. Yes.
So you can have that one.
Yeah, I have one where the Aleph is an upside down A, and Kaf is a K coming off of it.
Yeah, I think I've seen those. I'm not going to try to replicate that one. I just hope that California Mutt or whatever her name is, I hope she likes what I'm doing. And if you want to throw a rotten tomato, California, you go right ahead. Now, let's see. Now, what I mean is something like a division sign or a tilde or a greater than sign you don't necessarily use in everything you type. So if you don't use it a lot, you could sneak in your signature in there or some kind of monogram or, you know, or even a design if you have, you know, if you have a logo of some sort.
It says it looks great, Kate.
Thank you. I am so pleased. So anyway, California. So let's see. I wonder if she's willing. Her initials or his initials would be, I think, CM, right?
Yeah. If it's California.
Let's see if I can do a creditable CM. How about that?
Oh, that's beautiful.
There you go. Okay. And of course, one could make the C part a little more prominent or the M part, but let's leave it at that. Now, I know that I have a friend in Uganda who is probably going to watch this later because in Uganda, it's very, very early in the morning, but he does sometimes watch these shows. And I think I will
do one. It's very beautiful on the monogram.
And I think I'll do one for him, which is going to be, I think this would be nice. Emmanuel Ampereza. If you're watching, Emmanuel, this one's for you. In fact, I'm going to take a screenshot of it in case he likes it.
Very good.
Okay. We could actually have something like maybe a session which will be Colin and Kate does your monogram or something, you know? Mm-hmm. And it doesn't have to be for your real name, you know, if you want your favorite fictional character or something, you know, I'll try
John
it.
John Galt.
I mean,
went for John Galt.
Okay, you want him? Okay, yeah. Now they're all going to ask who he is. Okay. Well, let's see. With any luck, this will look a little... I think...
Oh, beautiful.
If he's real, I hope he likes this. Okay, if people want to know, let's just say he's the mysterious hero of a great big fat novel called Atlas Shrugged that people either love or they hate. Okay? And that's all I will say about it here. Okay? Either going to love it or hate it. I hope you love my monogram, whether or not you decide that you like the book. Let's see if we can have... Now, of course, we could have people or figures from mythology. I'm thinking, hey, I mean, if people and fictional characters can get monograms, why not mythical beings? I'll pick an easy one. Zeus, son of Cronos. There's Cronides. Easy, because the letters of his name happen to exist in an alphabet with which we're all familiar. But this is too plain. And come on, he was the god of lightning after all. Let's make this look like a lightning bolt. Okay? There we go.
This actually makes
this
was
way too big. Yeah, this was way too big. I just figure, okay, if any actual mythological being wants to sign up, wants to show up and have me do a monogram, I'll do it. But people can name their favorites if I happen to know the alphabet of the language that of the country that whatever beings, were revered in. I would consider doing this. Okay. Let's say, okay, all I can say is, okay, let's look, as long as we're doing Zeus, I'm going to try ancient runes Thor. I'm trying to remember. I cannot remember how you do an O in runes, but this was a TH sound. Okay. I'm going to go do it. I'm just going to do a little search. Isn't the internet wonderful? I don't want to screenshot it. I wanted to get on Safari. So if we're going to look up mythological and legendary beings, okay, I'm going to see how you spell Odin in runes, because there's more than one letter that stands for O, and I don't remember which one it is. But someone's gonna. Okay, so this way, if so, okay. Which is actually what I thought it was, but I wasn't really sure. So I can do a monogram for him, and it will actually be a pretty cool one. Actually, the Vikings were sort of into monograms. They called them bind runes, and theirs were much more complex than just putting the letters together. They liked to do things where they would overlap the parts, so they would they might have had something like this. I am not that great. In fact, I've heard that one way they can sometimes tell actual Viking era documents, carved stones or whatever, from forgeries is that the forgers aren't always as great as putting these mysterious hidden letters, secret codes, combinations of letters. In other words, they tend to be very pretty plain, just write things out, and they won't have every so often, something that in a way is a sort of picture puzzle and has to be untangled. Okay?
Okay.
So let's see, it's 11, that's already 11:02. We've been here for an hour and a quarter. Anything more? I tried to have a lot of fun tonight. I think
it was
more
fun. It was a lot of fun.
Because I think this was more fun than my original plan to go finish a font, But if someone wants me, I'm not promising that it will be this. It will probably be on my tablet, because I'm more comfortable working on mine, although this is a lot better for the big screen, but I think this is, more comfortable, and I'm hoping it will interest some folks in going out and either doing a font on their own, or if it comes to that, paying a company to do one. And I'm hoping
wonderful. Yeah. So before we sign off, I want to remind everybody that in July, there will be five Fridays instead of just four. Like,
yes.
And because of this, usually Kate's episode comes on the last Friday of the month, but next, you know, in July, she will be on the fourth Friday of the month, and we will do scribe songs on that Friday. And then the next Friday, we are going to talk about the history of the rondo musical form, and Kate has a contribution to that in the form of a rondo that she has written.
Well, I wrote the lyrics, in fact, for one that was about handwriting. Actually, I did write the lyrics of that. Now, I hope you don't mind. Now, I would like, before we close, to let you know that I am very much looking forward to this, and that if I have written anything else by that time, I know, are you having...
Can you turn the camera on to yourself now? Because we're just...
Certainly. I forgot to do that, and I do apologize because I'm so into doing all the fonts and all the things. But come on, trying to get that camera, and it's not letting me... Come on, settings, camera. Why is it not letting me turn it? I don't know. I sometimes have difficulty getting there.
Oh, okay. Very good.
There I am. I will tell you that if I write anything more, I know that often in the middle of the month, the third Friday, you often have a musical evening. Are you planning one for July also?
I would love to do it, but I have to check with Leslie Fish and with Katrina, because to see whether all the regulars are available or not. A lot of people have had some losses. You're not the only one to lose a parent.
Right. It was me and my husband too, you know, 2 months before. And the weird thing was neither of those was coronavirus. You know, a lot of the losses are not coronavirus, but are happening anyway.
Yes. Well, life goes on.
I'm very far from I've lost colleagues and so many people, and some of them were COVID and some of them, but a lot of them were not. A lot of them were just, things that could happen at any time, but there seemed to be a sort of cluster. I'm wondering if it could be that people are very stressed out and weakened, because there were, because there are other things that can mess you up besides, a virus, And sometimes these things do go in waves. Anyway,
Katrina lost both her parents this month.
Well, I tell you what, if she doesn't want to, and if they're not doing it, I think that by that time I might be up to doing some, I might do some of my songs and then save the rest for that fourth Friday.
Well, yeah, but we have two other musical opportunities that month because we're doing the your slot. You're going to
right.
be doing
right, and so that'll be my fourth Friday. Yeah,
and the one after that is the rondo and composer.
And I've got a little
Daniel Carter will be
I
on
did
that
write.
One.
They did write before my mom passed, so I would be very happy. My mom actually. So she never got to hear it. Sometimes I sang some of my songs for her. Didn't get a chance to sing this one. She was very, very, out of it, and she was in the hospital. She might have liked it because it's a song about handwriting, and she was an English teacher and did have to work on people's handwriting a lot.
Yeah, I'm sure she would have liked it.
Well, too bad. Well, it is. I'm sad about that. But in any case, I'm doing it because I do think of it as something instructional. In other words, if it was just singing for fun, I might still not be willing to do that. But for something instructional, I will give it a try. And I'm very glad to have this out. By the way, this one song that I was working on, if I do get it finished, I will, of course, save that for when we do scribe songs. And if it's, and if people like it, let's just say might let them license it if they, because it might be good enough. I'm not willing to just give it away, but we'll see. We'll see how we'll see how this goes. And as I recall, you are a publisher. If you ever want to do a book of handwriting songs by Kate, I wouldn't say no.
Okay, that's something I would be very interested in.
Okay, because I could certainly blow the dust off my old ones, fix them up a little. But for now, I hope that all of you will have some fun writing, whether it's on paper, on screen, you know, on a piece of paper that will be turned into a font, or on a screen that, you know, will produce fonts. Have fun with this. And if anyone wants to do anything and send some of it in, you know, why don't we have people who are watching, perhaps if they are inspired to get some of the font software whose links I've made available and to play around with it, maybe they could send you their fonts or links to their fonts. And then it doesn't have to be me in whatever month we might be doing fonts that have been made by hand. It could be a whole gallery of people. You know, I don't want to be the only one.
Okay.
And
that's
maybe
an
you
idea.
Could, you know, I would be thrilled if you would go and if you would get some of this font software, you know, and do, you know, a Paleo Hebrew Phoenician keyboard. And of course, to help people type in it, since most people who would type in that would be people who also know how to type in Hebrew, you know, use the key assignments from a Hebrew keyboard, if you will, because that way people.
Yes.
I just think it would make it, you know, it would make it easier, because a lot of people in Israel, I know, are very into archaeology from an early age. And, you know, they turn up, you know, 3,000-year-old writing, you know, in their backyard, you know, just putting in a barbecue pit or something, you know. So I know a lot of people are interested, and it would be obviously easier for them to play around with. Actually, what would be cool? What would be really cool, I have always thought, given that neither Paleo-Phoenician / Canaanite / Hebrew nor present-day Hebrew have an uppercase, why not make a font where the uppercase would be present-day Hebrew and the lowercase would be Paleo-Hebrew, so you'd have both?
Okay, that's a great idea.
There should be a way to do it, even if you had to mess with the keyboard assignments just a little bit. There should be a way.
The thing is that right now I have my own specialized custom keyboard, and the uppercase ones I use for final letters, you know, if I want.
You could still do this. I would say if you made the uppercase ones for final letters, make the uppercase be Hebrew, because, you know, Paleo Hebrew did not have that thing of doing different letters if it was at the end of the world.
That's true. You're right.
That it's interesting. We should actually look at the Hebrew, of basically what happened to go from Paleo Hebrew to Phoenician. We could talk about a wonderful book called A Book of Hebrew Scripts, which I actually have a copy of, which was produced by, it was produced at one of the universities in Israel by a paleographer, archaeologist.
What was it, the Hebrew University in Jerusalem?
I forget it was Hebrew University or Technion, but it was that sort of place. Thank you, honey. Put it down. I'm almost wrapped up. Anyway, we did little bits of different fonts. Andy, say hello to everyone.
Hi.
We now
hello.
Want to tell you what, over this month, I'll do a font just for you, but we were doing like different letters, you know, basically like a few letters from different fonts, basically to show the capabilities of this. So maybe I'll do a font for you, or you'll do a font for yourself. Anyway, okay. It's very interesting because they have historical things, including some letters from famous people. At one point, for instance, one of the documents they show is actually a military dispatcher letter from the, you know, from the Roman era Israelite military Hebrew Bar Kokhba, whose name is very well known to Israelis and to Jewish people, not well known to a lot of other people, but he's famous enough. You know, how often do you get to see the actual handwriting of someone that, if you're Israeli, you read about in school, but who was living 2,000 years ago?
Yeah, that's
so wonderful. We could actually talk about that and some of the really fun and surprising things that happened along the thousands years journey of the Hebrew script from what it was to what it is, and who knows what it might be in the future.
Okay, that's a wonderful topic for the future.
So I'll leave it to you to draw up the schedule and to put in any of these topics, if you don't mind. But
okay,
it is
we'll
getting late here. It's we've been here an hour and a half. I think we've got to log off so everyone can be wake up nice and refreshed and do all the fonts they want.
Thank you, Kate. We'll see you next time.
Thank you. Bye-bye.